Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome one and all to Bruton Parish Church, especially if you're new or visiting with us. We're very glad that you're here. I want you to know that you're welcome to participate in this service fully, and that includes coming forward for the sacrament at that time. You're welcome at God's table in this place. A host of announcements in your bulletins. If you're new or visiting with us and desire more information about Bruton Parish, and are interested in seeking membership at Bruton Parish, we have our newcomers corner right across the street, the White House, just to the left of the garden, right across the street, where we gather for coffee hour following this service. Make your way over there and meet our crack newcomers team, ready to talk to you about all things Bruton. ECW potluck supper, Bible study. We've got the Friends of Bruton day trip coming up to Richmond. Have a look at that information. St. John's and St. Paul's visiting in Richmond. And also the parish picnic coming up. More and more and more great stuff going on in this community. You will notice that we have extra musicians with us this morning. That is because we are celebrating this Eucharist as part of a Mass. You will notice there are special rubrics in your bulletin that will instruct you what to do at various points. Please read those rubrics and follow the instructions, and this will all be great, I promise. Last but certainly not least, in your upcoming chronicle, you will receive a notification of some very special things that will be happening as we move into our 300th anniversary of this building celebration. And it is my pleasure to announce to you our three visiting preachers and speakers for that 300th celebration. We will kick the year off with Bishop of London, who will be visiting us. Most of you saw him if you watched the last royal wedding on television. He was the celebrant and preacher for that occasion. Bishop Richard will be with us, and it's very, very exciting. We chose him because the Bishop of London had jurisdiction over the colonies when Bruton Parish was coming into existence. So we thought this would be sort of moving back to the beginning. Then we will have our own presiding Bishop Catherine with us mid-celebration to make sure that we are marching slowly but surely toward the culmination of this. And then we will end the celebration with Bishop Michael Curry of North Carolina, who is doing some groundbreaking work about what the future of the church looks like and how he's gearing up in the Diocese of North Carolina to be responsive to God's unfolding future. So three incredible personalities will be with us as part of this celebration. I hope you will come and be part. Again, welcome one and all. Perfectly love you, worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
Receive that, according to his promise, he abides with his church on earth, even to the end of the ages. Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, in glory everlasting.
Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. In the first book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up to heaven after giving instructions to the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. While staying with them, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father. This, he said, is what you have heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? He replied, it is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord, with the sound of the ram's horn.
Glory to you, Lord our Christ.
Jesus said to his disciples, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sin is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witness of these things, and see, I am sending you upon what my Father promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." Then he led them out as far as Bethany. In lifting up his hands, he blessed them. And while he was blessing them, he withdrew from them and was carried up into heaven. And they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they were continually in the temple, blessing God. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Blessed be the name of God. Please be seated. Terry and I have two sons, grown and families of their own. Our sons have adopted, or in some cases adapted, some of the more sardonic and satirical remarks I used while rearing them. They use them on their own children. I'm not certain my grandkids much appreciate it, but I do. Another part of the heritage continues. I am assured that they too will apply these quips to their own children, and 100 years from now, in a distant land, one of my great-great-grandchildren will wonder, "What in the world does that's the way the mop flops?" Well, additionally, they have tended to create their own remarks that will become part of the train of idiomatic treasure. For instance, when our teenage grandchildren begin to get into areas that are beyond their concern, our elder son is likely to say, "Nunya." They immediately know that this is shorthand for "none of your business." And they move on to take care of their own affairs. They're not always happy, but they do move on. In the Ascension accounts from Acts, Jesus' response to the question, "Is this the time when you will restore the kingdom?" strikes me as a bit of a nunya response. It is not for you to know the times or the periods that the Father has set down by his own authority. But Jesus does not leave it there. He makes it clear to them what is their business: to be witnesses in every place they find themselves, to the end of the earth. And that business is our business still. The places we occupy today would have truly been the ends of the earth to those men of Galilee and their limited horizon. This ascension moment we celebrate today does not mark Jesus' departure. Rather, the writer of Luke and Acts helps us to witness the beginning of how Jesus is to remain in each and all followers, equipped with power, clothed from on high, as the gospel proclaims. This is our heritage. Just as they were sent away from looking into heaven on a mission to spread the gospel of love everywhere in their reach, we are no less called to spread it in our reach. Looking to the heavens and mooning for a distant day of endless joy is not the gospel. The glories of heaven will resolve themselves. This ascension moment joins things earthly to things heavenly and presents the challenge to Jesus' followers to take that message to the world. It's a moment full of promise and full of expectation, promise that power comes from on high to equip Jesus' followers, that despite his departure, Christ abides yet with the church on earth. And expectation that the message of Christ can be taken to every nation, every part of the earth, in every age, and we are the instruments. Here in the Gospel of Luke, in Acts, in the letter to the Ephesians, is described the work of the church, the body of Christ. In that time, in every time, in this time, Jesus teaches and commissions the disciples to be witnesses wherever they go, and he departs from their sight, but not from their presence. Their first reaction is one that continues often today. There's always been a tendency to gaze heavenward in wonder. How much better things will be over in the glory land. To wonder what we should do to perpetuate the gospel than to just get on with perpetuating the gospel. Those immediate disciples were quickly called away from that heavenly trance, called to follow Jesus in the way. In this moment, Jesus takes humanity into the full presence of God and leaves behind the promise of comfort, of advocacy, of presence to come with the Holy Spirit. And he gives specific direction to receive that clothing of power. And when they receive it, we know they change the world. I wish I could stand here this morning and point to an ideal church throughout history. I'd love to say we've gotten it done. We've been the perfect entity. We've always done the great work of God. But what we have been and are is a collection of flawed and broken humans. And we have represented imperfectly, sometimes incompetently, the gospel of Christ and the kingdom of God. Throughout history, and even now, the church sometimes marries itself to oppressive regimes, supports sinful, murderous policies and practices, and is silent and complicit in clear violations of the gospel. But the church has also been courageous and bold, has confronted evil and stood with those who had no voice. The church has been all those things in all time. When I served in the Navy, we always used to say that it was an institution with 200 years of tradition unhampered by progress. There was truth in it. But of course, Actually, the functional navy of my time bore little resemblance to the one of John Paul Jones or even the one of World War II. And likely the navy of today is very much different from the one I left more than 16 years ago. So too the church. The church has always changed to accomplish its work in the world in which it dwells. The changes are functional. The core relevance is found in this gospel and in this timeless ascension moment where it's all connected together. The power of the church comes to us the same way that Jesus departed from on high, from the realm of God, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion and above every name that is named, in this age and in the age to come. Christ has made the head over all things for the church, which is his body. Christ dwells in heaven at the Father's right hand while simultaneously dwelling with and in us. We are empowered to be present and to do the acts in our time. The acts that those disciples that waited for the coming Spirit were equipped to do in theirs. Well, as Chris announced earlier, we are embarking upon a celebration of the hundreds of years of presence as the body of Christ in this place during what were incredibly changing times. Simultaneously, we prepare to continue to be that presence in the incredible changing times that are ahead. And some of our functions will change. Don't ask me at the door why, because I'm not being specific. But the gospel will remain the constant. We will not always get it right, but we will always be the body of Christ. We may not always be happy, but we will move on, knowing what is our business. The rest is none yet. Come away from a heavenward gaze, an idealized, complacent time of old, the bold and forward movement empowered by the Holy Spirit. Come to what awaits, and give to it all you can. Jesus will come the same way as you saw him go into heaven. Blessed be the name.
always with you.
Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving. Make good your vows to the Most High. Father, and to give you thanks. For you alone are God, living and true.
dwelling in light inaccessible from before time and forever. Fountain of life and source of all goodness, you made all things and filled them with your blessing. You created them to rejoice in the splendor of your radiance. Countless throngs of angels stand before you to serve you night and day. Beholding the glory of your presence, they offer you unceasing praise. Joining with them and giving voice to every creature under heaven, we acclaim and glorify your name as we sing.
Destroyed death.
made the whole creation new. We might live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose for us, he sent the Holy Spirit, his own first gift for those who believe, to complete his work in the world, and to bring to fulfillment the sanctification of all. And the hour had come for him to be glorified by you, his heavenly Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. At supper with them, he took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Father, we now celebrate this memorial of our redemption, recalling Christ's death and his descent among the dead, proclaiming his resurrection and ascension to your right hand, awaiting his coming in glory, and offering to you from the gifts you have given us, this bread and this cup. We praise you and we bless you. We praise you,
we bless you. We give thanks to you, and we praise you, Lord our God.
Lord, we pray that in your goodness and mercy, your Holy Spirit may descend upon us and upon these gifts, sanctifying them, showing them to be holy gifts for your holy people, bread of life and the cup of salvation, the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant that all who share this bread and cup may become one body and one spirit, a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your name. Remember, Lord, your one holy Catholic and apostolic church, redeemed by the blood of your Christ. Reveal its unity. Guard its faith. Preserve it in peace. Remember Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, Catherine, our presiding bishop, Holly, our bishop, Chris, Charles, John, and Bob, our clergy, Charlie, our seminarian, Jan, who is studying for the diaconate, and all who minister in your church. Remember all your people, and those who seek your truth. Remember the men and women of our armed forces, the community of Crisfield, Maryland, and for all the victims of Hurricane Sandy, the College of William and Mary, Holy Cross School in San Pedro Belize, and all those entrusted to our prayers for who know need. Remember all who have died in the peace of Christ, and those whose faith is known to you alone. Bring them into the place of eternal joy and light. And grant that we may find our inheritance with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, with patriarchs, prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all the saints who have found favor with you in ages past. We praise you in union with them and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty God and Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever.
Amen.
our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say.